Hello everyone, welcome to Embedded in IoT Enthusiast Learning Space. Today we'll be talking about IoT security and what are the challenges we have when we are deploying a lot of IoT devices that are essentially targeting consumer electronic, industrial or infrastructure. IoT market or IoT segment continues to grow. This means increasing number of devices that are opening a lot of security challenges. So increasing demand of IoT leading to a lot of embedded devices that are controlling critical infrastructure that can be industrial infrastructure, consumer infrastructure, and this actually creating a lot of vulnerability to cyber attacks, a lot of open threats. The main reason is there are not very clear set of security standards for developers, manufacturers to build a completely secure system. So there are different guideline or different practices that we need to consider, but that is not really, there is no clear set of rules that needs to be deployed or like some specific certification, clear set of certification that needs to be passed for having any IoT device in the market, to be launched in the market. So, and embedded systems getting deployed in IoT use cases, should be protected for all known, which are already known in the public domain, and unknown, so which are yet to be exploited. So those all attacks has to be, while designing a product, so we need to consider all those aspects. So this is also one of the main reason or main challenge in managing the IoT security. The main challenge is managing the IoT data. It's not just the connection that is vulnerable, but everything that is connected to hardware. So it can be your peripherals, and it can be your storage. It can be because if an attacker is able to gain access using some known vulnerability or known weak security measures, so then it can do a lot of things. It can basically, the worst case is it can shut down the hardware. It can basically cause them to overheat by overloading those overloading the CPU, or it can steal some sensitive data. And if there is not any root of trust or there is no trusted module, then it can lead to of stealing of the sensitive data. So what are the attack surface we can have for any IoT device? So broadly, we can have three attack surfaces. One is physical attack surface. We can have a network communication link and the application and software. So physical device essentially is the hardware, which can be the primary attack by any attacker. So the main part of device where vulnerability can come that can be from your memory. So memory can be your DDR, your can be your flash, and the firmware and the physical interfaces. The physical interfaces can be your unused I/O ports, can be SPI, I2C, MMC slot. There can be unused port as well as the used port. So those can be physical attack surfaces. Along with that, you can have web interfaces, network services. Attacker can also take advantage of unsecure default settings, outdated components, and any insecure update mechanism. So any over there update, if we are not doing securely and we are not doing with recovery in place, then it can lead to the malfunctioning of the IoT device. Then another attack surface area is the network communication link. So communication link can also be one of the main attack surface. So communication protocol, typically an IoT device which is being used in consumer section is using short range protocol like BT, Wi-Fi, Zigbee. And if the security is not really robust, let us suppose you are using Wi-Fi link, and if you are using weaker security, example, you are using web. So we know web can be attacked, and then definitely, that can lead to malfunctioning, or that can lead to attack of an IoT device. So instead of using web, we can go to WPA3, WPA2. And IoT systems are also sensitive to known to the network attacks such as denial of services and spoofing. So that denial of services can be caused with your communication link. So that also needs to be taken care. That also needs to be addressed. Apart from that, application software, so vulnerability in web applications and related software for IoT devices can lead to compromised systems. Web applications, for an example, to exploit it to steal user credential to post malicious firmware update. So that can be one classical example for an attack using the application and software surface. Now let's understand like how we can basically have some best practices that can lead to have a better hardware security or a better hardware device security. So as we know, many IoT deployments can be in the remote and isolated area. So that's basically an edge or a fog node, which is a sensor, wireless camera, or a router, makes them more prone to the physical attack, right? So what kind of measures we can have to have a better or this doesn't tell about like it can be foolproof, but it just have some best practices we can in place while designing a secure hardware. So first thing is the secure boot. Secure boot, we should while designing product, then we must have secure boot in place, which should be doing a root of trust from your boot ROM till the time your high level operating system boots up. So secure boot is the essential requirement for having a robust hardware security. Apart from secure boot, the next feature what we need to target while designing product is having a TPM. So we should have the trusted platform modules. So we should have some IP which can do the key management, which can basically save the critical secrets. So these are basically essentially the keys that are being used, so that is must. Apart from that, the trusted execution environment. So just while deploying any secure application, so for example, if we are having some IoT device that is leading to NFC payment using NFC link, then definitely reading the NFC, the element has to be done in the trusted execution environment. So for that, we should have the trusted execution environment infrastructure. So there are a lot of solutions available, Opti, TrustZone. There are proprietary solution available using the ARM TrustZone technology. So those must be in place while having any secure application. Apart from that, storage security is like we should be encrypting our essential storage, which is storing critical data, which is storing the radio parameters, which is storing some NV data. So then it has to, we should have some golden remote storage, which is encrypted using some mechanism. Then other thing is we need to remove unused hardware ports. It can be done while we are basically designing our PCB. So while schematic review itself, we can have some because what happens generally in a device life cycle during development, we tend to have a few ports which we want to use only for debugging purpose. So for example, UART, we can have a debug UART which is not required on a final version of your hardware. So we need to make sure to remove all the unused ports. We need to make sure there is no traces in the PCB so that anyone can blue wire and use that ports. So while designing our board layout or the schematic, we need to make sure we remove all of those aspects from our final version of the hardware, because those can be used to launch the denial of services attacks. So, and as well as very classical buffer overflow attacks can be done via those side channel.
Now let's discuss what are the best practices we can have for network level security or even system software point of view, what we can do. So first thing, what we can do from a network point of view, from the communication link point of view, is to use the better security protocol for the communication link. So in case you are having a Wi-Fi link as an node to gateway communication, then make sure we use WPA3 instead of having web or some legacy security protocols. So same we need to take care when we are using other short-range protocols like 15.4 or BLE. Then the next thing we need to try to have the two-factor authentication to have different level of privileges or even have the administrator account. So if we are providing any administrator accounts which are having more privilege, then better to have two-factor authentication. And then we should avoid using non-secure message exchange protocol and try to use secure protocol when we are interacting with gateway, cloud, or any other server. So we should use HTTPS, XMPP as a networking protocol. And then when we are having service discovery, peer-to-peer communication between nodes, then we should try to use secure MQTT protocol for service discovery and node-to-node communication. We should try to use server-based authentication scheme for root of trust between nodes. So whenever when node is powering up and we want to establish or we want that node to be part of some network, then we can have a server-based authentication for that node. And then from a system software point of view, what we need to make sure that we remove the unused services. So typically during development time frame, we have a lot of debug services that we use it for debugging purpose or for even for performance benchmarking. We have some services maybe that can be power benchmarking, CPU performance benchmarking, or thermal point of view. So we need to remove those unused services because those can be used for unauthorized access to the device, or they can become some mean to get access to the device. So if you are not if you don't want to have SSH to be enabled, then make sure you disable SSH service from host boot. And then make sure you don't have the Samba share in case because it can be used to share file across different operating systems. So that is also one key point we need to make sure. And then some multicast service discovery protocol that are not required, then those packages also we need to make sure we don't fork those daemons. And similar to that, the X server, so that basically that is used for a terminal display, and because that can handle any input from the devices like keyboard, mouse, and touch screen. So we should disable X server. So these are some of the services, unused services, then we need to make sure we remove from the postboot script. And apart from that, debug FS, if we don't want to give much debugging capability, then remove debug FS from the kernel. And some other debug scripts, try to remove or try not to provide some hooks, knobs that can basically do some and create some instability in the system. While designing any IoT product and while selecting the MCU or SOC, we need to make sure secure boot is supported. So while dealing with a proprietary or the non-open source hardware platform coming from key vendors like NXP, Microchip, Qualcomm, Intel, they have their own secure boot strategy, and it differs from vendor to vendor. But when we are dealing with open source hardware platforms like Raspberry Pi, ESP32, and we are not creating any massive scale of IoT product, we are doing for a deployment within home automation or some small scale IoT deployment, then we need to make sure what all the possible solution we have to have minimal secure boot solution that we can apply or that we can adopt for that IoT product. So I have just listed two cases here. So one with the Raspberry Pi and other with ESP32. So with Raspberry Pi, since the first is bootloader or the primary bootloader source in not in the public domain, so you can't really have the complete secure boot or complete root of trust. What at BEX you can implement is you can have one TPM module that can be integrated over SPI interface, and where you can provision keys, and then based on that you can have secure boot from your second stage bootloader to your high level OS. It can be from U-boot to your Linux operating system. So there are other solutions which there is one more solution provided by SwissBit. They provide secure boot solution that allows the encryption and access protection of the data stored in micro SD card, because when you are using Pi platform, then we are putting the images in the micro SD card. So we need some solution that can be used to encrypt and to be used for access protection of the data stored in the SD card. So we can have the SwissBit solution in Raspberry Pi when we are dealing with the small deployment of any IoT solution. Apart from that, there is Optiga Infineon TPM solution which uses the SPI interface in Raspberry Pi Linux environment. So these are some of the, there are other solutions are also available. Yeah, you can always browse and eval what suits best, but still, instead of having non-secure boot, we should have some at least what minimum secure boot which we can deploy in this product. Now let's discuss the secure boot solution for ESP32, ESP32S. So ESP32 has secure boot and the flash encryption which can be enabled from miniconfig. So if anyone creating small IoT application on ESP32, then he must need to enable secure boot from miniconfig. And it has, how the secure boot works in ESP32 is, it has eFuse, which is OTP, which is 1024 bit. It has four blocks, 256 bit block each. And now let's talk about, there are like two key blocks. One block is being used to store the AES decryption keys that is being used to decrypt the flash data. The flash controller uses AES decryption by reading the keys from the eFuse, one of the block of the eFuse, and one of the block key are being used for root of trust. On reset, the boot ROM begins execution. This is in the ROM within the hardware, hence it's trusted. The eFuse again in the hardware is trusted. Then what the boot ROM does, it looks up the RSA public key from the bootloader image and validate its checksum with the one of the stored key in the eFuse. So what it does, it reads and then basically verifies. So what it does, hash of the RSA public key is being validated with whatever the RSA is basically embedded in the image. And then the RSA public key is used to validate the bootloader itself using the RSA sign verification mechanism. So this is the high level, any secure boot implementation, or this is high level designs for any secure boot. So this is the summary of all the best practices with respect to security in any IoT devices.